Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Mason Dambrot, your host. We're here today with Jesse Prinz, culturalist and neurophilosopher, also a distinguished professor at CUNY Graduate School. Welcome.
Terrific to be here.
I would ask first if you could tell us a bit about the neurophilosophy of morality, very briefly, and then how morality entails or is related to the emotions that give rise to moral positions or moral judgments, and of those, what are innate, if any?
Great. Well, I mean, morality is really the study of our judgments about what's right and what's wrong, what's good, what's bad, permissible, impermissible. And for a long time, philosophers and even some psychologists thought that the fundamental capacity that led to our moral sense was reason, that we reflected and arrived through a reasoning process at conclusions about what's right and wrong. But increasingly, people in psychology and neuroscience are discovering that emotions seem to be at the basis of this. And this was actually David Hume's view back in the 18th century. So philosophers had recognized this link, but that view hadn't been in vogue, and it's come back full force. So there are a lot of experiments. So to give you one example, describing some work that I've done with a collaborator in psychology named Angelica Seidel, we induced emotions, not moral emotions, just things like disgust, irritation. We played irritating music for people. We played repulsive sounds, like the sound of vomiting. We even induced positive emotions by playing cheerful music.
I hate you already.
Then we asked people about morality. So from their perspective, these were separate tasks, but what ended up happening is the emotions affected people's judgments. So if you play something disgusting and then ask them, say, is cannibalism all right in a survival scenario where you're in an accident and the only way to survive is to eat a dead body, people are more likely to say no if they've just heard a repulsive sound.
So it kind of affects almost a cognitive framing, if you will, within which something is evaluated.
Absolutely. And one way to think about that cognitive framing is what people do to decide whether something is right or wrong is a lot like what they do when they decide whether they like a food or not. They see how they feel. So if you give me something to taste and you say, how do you like it? I'm going to introspect, and I say, delicious. And that feeling, that gustatory pleasure, is what I report.
Quite right.
Give me a moral scenario, I'll do the same. How do I feel about cannibalism? Suddenly, I'm feeling disgusted, not because of the scenario, but because of the music or the sounds, and I misreport that I think cannibalism is unacceptable in this circumstance, even though under other conditions, I might have reported that it's just fine.
So that, if I understand you, that makes it a strong contender for a form of embodied cognition, because we're not logically coming to an induction or deduction about something we are observing, but actually we're checking in with our physicality.
I'm so glad you put it that way. It's exactly right, because it's important to see that the emotions are not just other forms of thinking. They're not judgments in the sense that we use reasoning to arrive at them. They're actually deeply embodied. So to know how you're feeling is really to know how your body is reacting. To know you're afraid is to feel yourself tremble.
It's very clear now that I hear you say it. On top of that, also, some of the neuroscience evidence that I'm aware of is supremely supportive of this, in that reason often occurs after the fact in the frontal cortex and other areas, whereas emotion occurs primarily in the reticular activating formation, the limbic system, the amygdala, and other more primitive brain structures, which are more closely connected to the physical body through interfaces with the hormonal system and some other things. So does that fit with what you're saying as well?
Absolutely. And every single neuroimaging study that's been done on morality has shown an increase in activity in these emotion structures. So we see emotions again and again as a common denominator. It doesn't mean that cognition isn't part of the story. And I think you nailed it when you said we bring in justifications after the fact. You experience an emotion, but now you need to tell a story about why that emotion was appropriate. So cognition or thinking is playing catch up to feeling in the moral domain.
And that would make sense, because if that initial emotional response then has to, if we have to tell a story, it's because that occurred at a level to which we don't have primary access,
exactly,
in a sense.
Exactly.
How does this then relate to how innate something concerning morality and emotions might be? I don't know how many people still claim that there is a moral module in the brain. I don't subscribe to that personally. But perhaps you could address those views and how they relate to your perception of the events.
Great question. And if you look at the history of this, many people who thought emotions were at the foundation of morality also thought morality was innate. And why not? Lots of our emotional responses are part of our biological makeup. But increasingly, we're seeing evidence that the emotions that we have and the conditions under which we have them are heavily informed by culture. So even taking an example as local as the debates between liberals and conservatives, Democrats and Republicans, we see people with radically different moral values. And it's not just that they've worked out different policy implications for the same underlying values. Often their core values differ. So where conservatives might be really interested in upholding a traditional family structure, liberals tend to reject that as a moral foundation. Where conservatives might be concerned with things like honor or authority or even purity of the self or the soul, liberals tend to ignore those things and think more about equality, capacity for flourishing, letting each person do as he or she wills. So I think we can find tremendous variation. And the best way to think about this is that culture is a kind of emotional learning ground where each of us learns to react emotionally to whatever members of our community have been recommending.
So it's a process of kind of successively mapping our innate emotional response, our embodied response to the environment, to particular cultural events and interactions we have with our context at large.
That's right. That effect. So maybe next to team sports, political debates on television incur more emotional response than just about anything else. So you're a young kid, you haven't yet learned to think about any political issue in an informed way, and you see your parents gesticulating positively or negatively in response to whatever some candidate has said on the tube. Now, you're going to pick that up. Humans are great imitators. Humans might experience a certain kind of emotional sanction. If your kid misbehaves or even has the wrong political view, you're going to react very strongly, and that's going to leave an impression. So we see this kind of emotional conditioning as a very central feature of our social environment from the earliest days.
It reminds me of a documentary from a very long time ago that I saw where it was in the Bible Belt in the United States. Where speaking in tongues and snake handling and some of these other practices are at least at that point in time, were relatively commonplace in certain communities. And the young children who were there, you could see them going through the learning process, imitating the physicality. And then when they got a little older, the forms of proto-speech that were particular to speaking in tongues. So that's the first thing that came to mind.
That's a lovely example. I think religious socialization is very similar to moral socialization. And what we need to keep in mind is that both sides of these debates are equally socialized. So one consequence of an emotional view about morality is we shouldn't think too much about which moral system is the right system. We should just recognize that people, as a result of socialization, end up with different systems. And if we want to start to assess morality, we need to step outside of that whole emotional framework and start to think about things like implications or consequences. What are the social consequences of having one set of moral rules over another set of moral rules? If we lay out a clear set of goals for a stable society, we may be able to pick between moral systems without having to rely on our emotions to dictate which one is right.
And the belief that these are innate does not help that effort.
It absolutely doesn't. And in fact, if you think about morality as a kind of tool, like any tool, it's one we can improve and perfect. Now, there's no correct way of making a hammer. But if you define a goal, I want a device that's going to easily drive a nail into a piece of wood, that places some constraints on what would make a hammer more useful for that end. And I think we need to think about morality as this tool that we can constantly reconstruct as we set our ends.
One last question. You had mentioned in some of the material I read about non-moral emotions. I found that very interesting. I was wondering if you could explicate that a bit.
Well, a non-moral emotion is just an emotion that might arise in a context that has nothing to do with morality. And some of the ones we talked about, like disgust, are a case in point. So if you ask somebody what's disgusting, the first thing they might say is rotting food, or a bodily product, something that has nothing to do with morality. But we then take this non-moral emotion and we apply it to the moral context. The non-moral emotions are the foundation of morality. And I think once we see that, we see another reason for thinking that morality is not innate. It's rather borrowed from a more rudimentary emotional capacity and then transferred over to the social domain.
And hence, this last point, that the mechanism, if you will, at least at a descriptive level of the study that you did, because there's something disgusting that frames it. And then especially since you talk about a morality as pointing towards another, then if that person somehow is connected with a disgusting stimulus, there will be an emergent moral judgment about that person's behavior.
Absolutely right. So you can think about this biological form of disgust. We don't like, say, rotting flesh because it makes us sick. Now apply that to a social context. So say somebody has been the victim of a brutal murder. The response that people are going to have to that is going to be a disgust response because that's the innate response to destruction of the body. But now it's a moral context. So an observer who sees this disgust response is going to start having a disgust response to brutal murder. So it's been transferred from something very biological to something that's much more social in nature.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.